Welcome. I'm the founder of the Erasmus Center for Entrepreneurship. And my PowerPoint's there. I just flew in from Doha yesterday. They told me I could also do in the afternoon a presentation. Maybe it was better, but it was no, I couldn't make it. Let me see. I'm going to talk about science and entrepreneurship. I'm from the Netherlands, and the Netherlands is a pretty small country, but we are pretty good in economic output. And I couldn't find a number one position. We're good in agro export. But maybe in this year we will win the FIFA World Cup and beat Spain, because I'm in Spain today. So I hope that. We are talking about 4 years from now. It's the topic of the seminar or the global conference. And I think we have a lot of challenges out there in Europe, in the rest of the world. We are lacking resources. We have flus. We have a graying population, recessions. And I believe that we can solve these challenges by new innovations, and that comes to come from the combination of science and entrepreneurship. If you look at science, we have an interesting situation in Europe. We have strong academic centers. For decades, we were strong, and we're still very strong in our research output. A lot of times, we belong in Europe among the top in the world. For example, in the Netherlands, we have 12 universities in the top 200, and we are number 3 in the world of biomedical field, in the biomedical field. But if you look at the economic output of that, we are not so good in making this knowledge turning into business. For example, we are 3rd in my biomedical field. 1st is Switzerland, 2nd is America. But if you look at what we do with innovation, we are a follower, and we're lacking behind. And that's strange. We have these new insights from universities, from research. But if you look at our innovative capacity, we don't have new innovative products. And that's what we call the knowledge paradox, a European knowledge paradox, because it's in the whole of Europe. Let's look at entrepreneurship, where we're talking about a combination of these two. And entrepreneurs are a driving force of an economy. On the right, you see that the most net jobs created are created by startups and not by the big companies. Second, entrepreneurs make things happen. They really make sure that an idea goes to market and thereby becomes an innovation. Because an innovation is an innovation when it comes to market. Before a product or a service is not on the market, we're not talking about innovation. It's an idea. But then the problem is, how do you foster entrepreneurship? How do you get more entrepreneurs that create or make an innovation happen? So, my passion and goal is this knowledge paradox, to solve it and to stimulate entrepreneurship. I created a company 7 years ago with a business colleague called Halban Gunrat, and our payoff is turning knowledge into business. And next, that we advise governments and universities and set up programs and projects to do this, we invest ourselves approximately in one startup a year, because I like startups and innovation. Some projects I'm now the leader of a federalization program. It's a program to make the innovation system in Rotterdam better. I got 50 million of funding, 5 million by the Ministry of Economic Affairs. You see here, I get a check of 5 million, not from my bank account, but still, it was nice to give. I lead a program in south of Holland between 3 universities. It's an 8.5 million program in dollars. I set up an investment competition worldwide, 32 countries. It's making sure that startups and investors find each other. And the Erasmus Center for Entrepreneurship. So who am I? I'm Dutch. I live in the Netherlands, and for 30% in Monaco. That's my parents and my girlfriend and the Prince of Monaco. I have a master's degree in entrepreneurship and strategy economics. And I wrote 2 books, one on investment and one on internationalization of small and medium-sized enterprises. And currently I'm writing my 3rd book. It's about knowledge transfer, the process of making knowledge valuable for society. I'm doing the Professor Klaase. He's an entrepreneur and 20% academic. He set up 16 companies in the life science sector. And this knowledge we used, combined with experience of my knowledge transfer with my company, to make a new model. In this model, we call the knowledge transfer cycle. But basically, we say, okay, there are 4 domains to get knowledge transferred and eventually make impact on society. You have science domain, where researchers are busy with finding new insights and getting research output. Then you have a business development phase, where you can see if this research, theoretical insights, are also possible in practice, and if you can get it to the market. Then you have a market introduction, and then you go eventually, with your new innovation, you make impact on society. With the impact on society, you create also new demands, because you have a new innovation, and then there will be new demands, and this can be inspiration for researchers to do other research again. The purpose is that we now try to have a cycle where knowledge and money and data is continuously flowing, instead of only these researchers in the top and somewhere the market and somewhere society. And this way, everybody benefits, and we think you can have a sustainable situation. We derived 10 steps. I'm going to first look at the science part. Here is the knowledge paradox. You have these researchers, they're doing a great job. They have ideas to research, they do research, and they have output. For example, a research paper with new insights, or something defined in technology or in the laboratory. But then they go again, they say, ah, great, we have this new thing we saw. And they spread it around among peers around the world, so also research, the scientific field. And they go on with the next idea. So it stays in the university. And why does it happen? Because researchers are evaluated on their research output. They want academic recognition. That's the first and priority goal of researchers. Second, they give lectures at universities for students. Okay, that's what they do. But then the third thing they should do is knowledge transfer. That's a last priority of researchers. And I think one of the problems is incentives. They don't have the incentive to do that. And we're figuring out how to do that in the last years. And you see different models that maybe scientists get cash back if they put a license into or patent to the market. In Sweden, for example, they call it a professor privilege. And then the professor could have 100% benefit of everything that will be made with his knowledge. And I thought, okay, maybe that will be a good incentive. But in the end, it was not so great if you look at the output of this regulation. What we see is that if you really want to motivate the system, all stakeholders have to be involved. So the professor has to be some stake in this patent, like 30% or 20%, but also the university have to benefit, because then the university is also pushing to get this researcher filing this patent and get this patent on the market. For example, Erik Laassen, who I talked about a few minutes ago, made around 40 million for Erasmus University with some medical companies. And this 40 million is back, putting back into research again, so a lot of researchers had money to do research again. And that's why he got a lot of attention and a lot of recognition, so the universities give him the freedom to undertake other projects. So that's the knowledge paradox. Then business development. When you have a new insight in research, this is still theoretical. So you have to see if it's also worked in practice. That's the proof of concept phase. In this proof of concept phase, you look if it's really viable or not, and you test your assumptions. Then you have an evaluation phase. Why? You have to evaluate if these new innovations are also ethically possible, or and if it's legally. I give an example. Last week I was at the medical faculty, and now they found out that it's also possible to 3D print an embryo. So instead of getting a picture of your embryo, of when you're pregnant, you can have a 3D model. And I said, oh, that's pretty cool. But then we start evaluating, like, is this ethical to do this? Maybe your child will not be born. And then, so a lot of times you have innovations that are in a gray area of, is it legal, is it ethical? And is there a business? So if this is yes, 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 then you go to an upscaling phase, you scale up, and you go to market. In the market, you do a market introduction, you get consumer feedback, thereby creating new unmet needs and demand circulation. And this demand circulation can be inspiration for researchers to do research again. Can you step one of these domains? Yes, you can go from research immediately to the market. But what I explained, maybe you rush to market and make mistakes. Maybe the product doesn't work. Maybe there's an ethical issue or a legal issue. So we think you can skip some steps, but we want to make sure that you know which steps you didn't take. Sometimes you see also that the researcher just gives the knowledge to the market, but then it goes wrong because they don't understand each other. The research is still too much in a fundamental stage. Can you give it immediately to society? Yes. Sometimes research output insights are given to governments about how to tackle certain issues or certain crises. But then there's no continuous flow because the money that's made is not going back to research, and also the data that is collected in business development and in the market is not coming back to the research part. So, I want to talk a little bit more about the business development. This is a phase that goes wrong a lot of times. And I have two examples. I have drugs development as an example, and I have some projects I did how to foster entrepreneurship. If you look at the drug development, it takes 33,000 findings in research to get one drug on the market. So imagine all these research we have in the university and only one makes it to market. It takes 4 to 12 years to get it from research to the patient. And it costs around, drug development, around $1,250 million per drug. It's an average. It's excluding the production, the marketing and distribution of the medical. So one big problem is the valley of death, because you don't, how do you finance that as a startup from a medical company? It's impossible. So we did front-loading cash, and that is that we say, okay, normally if you develop a drug and you go to market, you get 10, 15% royalties. We said to the industry, lawyer, give us a lower royalty, because a lot of times we will not go to market, but give us upfront milestone payments. Give us money every time we have a milestone, when we created value. Because every time you have a milestone, your company will be more worth, and they can pay for that. I give an example. We had one new possible drug, and when we disclosed it, we asked money for that. So we told the pharmaceutical companies, we have this new drug possibility, and you're interested. And 5 were interested, and we told them, okay, you can look at what we have, but it costs you 50,000 euros. And 3 of them paid. And one of them, we co-developed the whole cycle. And every time we had a milestone, they put money in. In this way, we front load the cash, and you have some benefits also. You're looking if this patent or this new technology you have is really step limiting, if it's really valuable for the bigger companies, if they need it. If it's step limiting, they limit the steps of the other companies. You have a net present value check, and when a bigger company is investing in the earlier stage, they're committed to help you, and they have a lot of knowledge and guidance for that. Just some insights is nice to know, maybe. Since you have a short period of time to get your money back, because you have 20 years of patent and 12 years of development, in 8 years, you have to have a return on investment of this drug, not only development of this drug, but also development of all the other drugs that failed. So every day that you're later on the market, you lose a lot of money. We're here in a small blockbuster, you lose 82,000 per day. Because when your patent expires, the market, the cost, and the price of the medicine goes rapidly down because other will enter the market. And what in the medical field they do is, of course, they have patents, but it's only 20 years and it's difficult. So what they can do is also use trademark protection and design protection. And a lot of times also in other markets, I see that they just forget also the startups to do the trademark and the design protection. And the patent is difficult, it's 20,000 euros for a European patent, but a trademark or design protection is 1,000 euros or 500 euros. An example of a medicine that did a good job is this. Anybody knows who did it, what it is? It's Viagra. So, what they did is they protected the color, the way it's shaped, and the name. And a lot of people recognize now this brand. So after the patent is gone, they still have this brand and can continue to be a premium brand. Next to that, they found out that it's a famous, it's good for anti-jet lag. So now they have a patent for anti-jet lag on the same substance and not for Viagra purpose. So maybe you want to try it in a plane sometimes, but that's your responsibility. Maybe nice to know when they did the Viagra, 24% of the people had positive effect with placebo. So that's just some insights. So maybe we have to invest also in placebos. So some examples on how to foster entrepreneurship. I told you about the Holland Program Entrepreneurship. This is in, first. In Holland, we say, we have a need for entrepreneurs. So we invested $150 million in education for entrepreneurs. Why? We can inspire youth, we can give them the skills and capabilities and insights and knowledge how to set up a business. I set up one of the programs from 8.5 million and we did it with three universities. Why three universities? Because they were located within 1 hour of traveling and there were a technical university, a business university, and a science-based university. And I think if you have these different knowledge, skills, and know-how together, you can create good startup teams which can have new innovations. Some examples, in Holland we have problems always with the wind and the rain, and this umbrella always breaks. So they come up with a new umbrella that is storm resistance. This is technical guys with business guys coming together and say, hey, how can we solve this problem? In Rotterdam we have a lot of containers. Technical guy said, hey, why can't we fold this and make less space in ships? These guys have a new game. They only figured it out a few months ago. They were business guys. They wanted to have a new game with you can play outdoor, and it's a combination of a shuttle and a beach volleyball. They found an industrial designer, and with 3 months, they made this project, and now it will be sold this summer in 10 countries. So results, in Holland we did this whole investment in education, on entrepreneurship, and now we are number one in the Europe if you look at how many entrepreneurs we have. In 2001 we had 5% entrepreneurs, now we have 8% entrepreneurs. So we're 15 worldwide. Side note, we have a lot of people that lost their jobs and become an entrepreneur without employees. So the problem is now that we lack ambitious entrepreneurs. A lot of companies in Holland, and I think also in Europe, they don't grow further than 5 employees. And we want, for economic growth, employees, companies that go on 5 employees. So I created the Russell Center of Entrepreneurship, and we empower entrepreneurs. I created with 3 professors, one in the economic field, one in entrepreneurship, and one in the medical field. We're around 50 employees, and what we do research. We're in the top 5 worldwide. We do education. We educate 3,500 students every year and around 600 entrepreneurs. These are startups, but also the SMEs. So we help with start, growth, and renewal of companies because a lot of SMEs out there, they are, have to change their business model. They have to turn around. And we help several big corporates. We have 3 programs, a Get Started program, a Get Business program, and an Accelerator program. Get Started is all about from idea to reality. You have an idea. A lot of people have an idea, but they never start. And I think if you put them in the group together and they can try to see if this idea is working, you can really have a start. And then there's a business phase where you have to get sales. I think the biggest fail factor of starting companies is that they lack sales. They just simply cannot sell their product or service. And if you cannot sell it, you're out. And then we have an accelerator program to get to 1 million in revenue. And the biggest fail factor in accelerating is cash flow. One of my companies last week got bankrupt because we ran out of cash. And we had enough customers, we had 10,000 customers, we were going fast, but cash was out and then we couldn't pay the bills. I think my last thing is, 2 things I want to do. I think you get a lot of innovation hubs in the world. If you look at 4 years from now, there will be innovation hubs where science meets business, where science meets entrepreneurs. I'm creating one in Rotterdam, it's called the Rotterdam Science Tower. And because we want to create an infrastructure where starting and growing is possible and you're supported. There are 3 towers in Rotterdam. And one of the towers is now the Science Tower. It's strategically located. It's nearby airports, the highways and the public transport. And we have 4 sections. One is education. Second is offices. Third is laboratory, medical space, and a sky bar. In the medical space, we have an incubator and a lab hotel. An incubator is for the spin-offs of the Rasmus University, and a lab hotel is where you can rent a lab for a month or for 3 weeks or for a day, because a lot of times for startups it's difficult to get a laboratory. It's not only for medical purpose, but also for example, we have now one guy who's setting up a company for air filtering to get more better air. Another guy is getting gold out of mobiles and needs a laboratory for that. But for them it's difficult to get a lab, and here they can rent for 1 month and they can also rent the equipment. Second is we launching a startup campus. It's a 1500 square meters floor where all the facilities are there to help you as a startup. It's lecture rooms, it's a fitness area, a startup bar and everything. These are some figures. And the 1st of March this Saturday, the Prime Minister of the Netherlands will open it because he believes also in this concept. This is phase two. When we have the first tower completed, we'll have also the second and the third tower, and we make a sky bar. In total, we have 140 square meters of business development. And the purpose is that the researchers go out of the university and go into this tower and work with entrepreneurs side to side. And they are then out of this scientific field. And then I think it's possible for them to get new innovations. My time is almost up. I have one last example. It's Gathering. It's a new investment competition. It's worldwide. I have a short video, if I can make, it's 1 minute. Technique, no? Yep.
In a multiverse of high potential startups and attract investors, an evil paradox has been in play. It's as if they existed in two completely different worlds. The world of smart money, where investors were starving for great new concepts and entrepreneurs. And a world where extraordinary startups were dying from the lack of funding, knowledge, and network. But what if we could make these worlds collide? That's where GetInTheRing comes into play. GetInTheRing is a multi-purpose tool that helps solve the investment paradox. It's an on-ground concept that's going viral. It's a decoding that brings international startups and investors closer together. And it's a global competition where the 8 most promising startups meet each other in the international finals, get the rockstar treatment, and swear off in an attempt to secure an investment
It's just an example of an event I created in the last 5 years. It's now global, and we did it as a Russell Center for Entrepreneurship. Why we did it, we saw a lot of startups saying, I cannot get an investment, and we saw investors saying, I cannot find the good entrepreneurs. So we tried to have the best of the world together. We do it in a different way. We have a boxing ring. We have two at the same time in the ring pitching in 5 rounds. They get 5 questions, because a lot of times the pitching of entrepreneurs is not so good, and they miss certain valuable information, so they get 5 questions, what's your business model, what's your market, your achievements, and your proposition, and there's only one winner. Out of 40,000 events, we were chosen in Rio de Janeiro by the Kauffman Foundation as one of the best events on entrepreneurship stimulation. This year, we expect around 2,000 companies participating, startups, at 40 countries. We have 7 regions. Every region has its finalist. And in the end, we have 8 finalists in Rotterdam in the finals and 1 winner. So this was my presentation. I had to rush a little bit. But in the end, I say, I believe in the science and combination of with entrepreneurship. You have to stimulate that, create a sustainable knowledge cycle I talked about. I think you have to work together in a golden triangle. And I think we have to solve this knowledge paradox together. If there's any questions, it's my contact information. If you need more or if you want to go in depth sometime, I think it's time for questions, if there's possibility or not.
Sure, if you want to take a question. Stop. Any questions?
It's a little bit dark to see all.
Then we're ready.
Thanks.
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.